Here, in Syria, world war is not a possibility or a theory. It is reality. Since the beginning of the war on Syria in 2011, the nation has seen the armies of around 62 countries. To place this in context, the landmass of Syria is but two-thirds that of Britain. Though the US-led alliance in Syria, which notably includes Britain and France, entered the war claiming that it was merely there to oppose Islamic State and their various counterparts, its real intentions are today very clear. Not only is there evidence which reveals that the US is in fact arming and funding the terrorist groups it claims to be in Syria to oppose, its role in the war has increasingly been revealed as that of conquest. This is very clear in both policy and in action. Russia joined the Syrian war in September 2015 after an official request from the Syrian government. Despite the US and Britain's claims that they are in Syria to combat the same enemy, both of these imperialist powers turned down Russian attempts to start discussing cooperation in October 2015. Since then, tensions between these powers have escalated steadily. The reasons for this are simple. The US and its allies are in Syria to further expand their influence over the Middle East. Russia is in an alliance with the Assad government, which they must overturn in order to do so. As Russia's interventions have tipped the war in favour of the Syrian government, these contradictions of interest have only sharpened. This is made clear by the near escalation of airstrikes by the US, Britain and France into open conflict with Russia in April.
I hope that they will refrain from any further escalation of this situation.
With the US's illegal presence in Syria now to be permanent, this antagonism could flare into open conflict at any moment. Viewed in context of the analysis developed throughout the rest of this film, it is clear to see that the war on Syria is an expression of a broader process. It is a live front in a world confrontation. Moreover, there are other such fronts, with the war today still raging in eastern Ukraine, serving as a similar expression. These are the blistering wounds of the crisis, where masses of humanity are already being wiped out in pursuit of what the US terms great power competition. Unless the causes of these wounds are attended to, they will simply spread. Reality is demonstrating this. Whilst writing and editing the rest of this film, the crisis has picked up pace considerably. In late October, Trump announced that the US would be withdrawing from the Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty, with the intention to station mid-range nuclear warheads in Europe. Though Russia maintained that it was willing to continue discussion with the US to resolve the question, it stated that it would have no option but to respond to a US withdrawal. Sure enough, Putin revealed that Russia now possesses hypersonic weapons capable of evading any air defense system on the 19th of November. With the US's plans to station its warheads in Europe, this move has also served to escalate tensions between the EU and the US. Shortly after Trump's announcement, on the 6th of November, the French President Macron called for the creation of an independent European army, significantly listing the need to face down the US as one reason for his proposal. Just as world leaders were set to assemble to mark the 100th anniversary of the 1918 armistice, he reiterated this call. The German Chancellor Merkel has since joined him. It is clear to see that US imperialism is pursuing a strategy of aggressive competition and confrontation against Russia and China. However, sober analysis reveals that a further confrontation, that between the US and Europe, is today a reality of imperialist society. The centrality given to this conflict in this film is intended to demonstrate the depth of the crisis facing this society. that this alliance, which has subsisted since 1945, is today falling into ruin, is a clear indication that the imperialist crisis is forcing a third redivision of the world between great powers. The conditions for world war are clearly forming. Whilst it is uncertain how long it may take these contradictions to flourish, or how the alliances of such a war may fall, its fundamental basis is today undeniable. That the US is already treating this as a living reality can be seen in several elements of its military approach. The National Defense Strategy, announced early in 2018, is already being implemented in US military training for what is termed multi-domain combat within a 2025 to 2040 timeframe. This includes both space and cyberspace as active realms of combat between what the US calls peer adversaries, ending any notions of the kind of military parity which subsisted during the so-called Cold War. Beyond this, the US is openly discussing the likely reality of a Third World War in military theory, with a collection of papers entirely devoted to this subject published by the US Army Command and General Staff College Press in 2017. The introduction to this collection clearly demonstrates that the US understands fully its relationship to the EU imperialist bloc. Put together, this indicates a reality. We must see and face it. Midnight is staring at us plainly. Just as Marxism is able to understand the causes of this confrontation, it is also able to grasp the solution to it. That solution is simple. It is us, the working class. The revolutionary role of the proletariat in Marx's work is not the result of moral reasoning, but of scientific historical analysis. The organization of capitalist production requires that the working class possess nothing to sell, save for our own labor power. This means that we have no material interest in the maintenance of capitalist society whatsoever. Its existence as a social system is predicated upon the mass of humanity being dispossessed. This is an historically unique phenomenon, as the oppressed classes of previous social systems often still held a material interest in the systems they existed within. For example, small landholdings were granted to peasants in exchange for the labour that they did on a landowner's estate. The significance of this unique condition to the proletariat's existence is enormous. As we have no interests remotely in capitalism, the only possible political expression of the working class's material interests is the end of class society itself. Not only does capitalism create its gravediggers in the working class, it furnishes humanity with the tools by which to organize a new society.
It's sun is sinking, the cattle go devils go down, it's red in the swings at on.
The productive forces produced by capital accumulation undeniably represent an enormous step forward for humanity. Crucially, the various new productive forces created by capitalist development create a change in the way that people work. The precise nature of this change is identified by Marx in Capital. The way in which capitalism organizes production leads to what Marx terms the socialization of labor. This more and more eliminates individual, artisanal, or handicraft forms of labor, replacing them with industrial labor, which requires the labor of groups. This means that it is possible to organize production collectively and rationally, rather than according to the irrational dictates of private profit. The concentration of production under monopoly capitalism and imperialism has heightened this contradiction further. To put this simply, the cartels formed between monopolies can fix the quantity of goods to be produced between them. If they can do this, then it must also be possible to organise production in accordance with need. What prevents this is merely that capitalism is socially organised to produce profit. Its development has opened up the possibility of a classless society, with the forces of production owned collectively and production organised rationally. That is, socialism or communism. Humanity already possesses the resources. Whilst the history of the communist movement is beyond the scope of this film, it is worth highlighting that this history demonstrates that Marxism can attend to the most pressing questions of our age. It is unquestionable that the threats of imperialist war and the environmental crisis are the most pressing and urgent political tasks facing our species. Two examples are required to demonstrate that they can be overcome. The October Revolution of 1917 ended not only Tsarism and capitalism in Russia, but also the First World War. The victory of the revolution on the 11th of November set in motion a revolutionary wave, with mass desertions in the French army, a 1 million strong general strike, the Spartacist uprising, and the mass mutiny of sailors in Germany, and the rise of Red Clydeside in Britain. In Russia itself, the fundamental question underpinning the Bolsheviks' victory was their steadfast opposition to the war, as both the Tsarist monarchy and the capitalist provisional government refused to end it. The world's first socialist state was one with a simple slogan: bread, land, and peace. Its impact was such that the imperialists were forced to end their war of conquest and plunder. As the then British Prime Minister Lloyd George said, "Our real danger now is not Germans, but Bolshevism." Today, the legacy of the Bolsheviks still lives on. In Cuba, socialism is demonstrating that it is capable of solving the environmental crisis. In 2006, the Worldwide Fund for Nature's Living Planet report pointed to Cuba as the only environmentally sustainable nation on the face of the planet. It has continued to improve both its sustainability and living standards since. This is a stark proof of a simple fact. Capitalism is unable to solve the environmental crisis. Socialism can. The imperialists are holding the world to ransom. We gain to benefit nothing from the war and destruction that stands ahead of us. We have so much to win by objecting to it. The emergence of space warfare as a sincere promise of the imperialist counter-revolution demonstrates something immensely powerful. If we dare only to think what might be achieved if this technology were put to its opposite use. Today, we are upon the verge of exploring space on a scale comparable to seafaring. Not only is space exploration possible, but we possess the technology today to eliminate disease, to ensure a sustainable energy future, and reconcile ourselves with the Earth as a species properly. Poverty can be eliminated. That is simply a fact. And this truly is the most important lesson of Marx and Lenin's work for our present moment. Imperialism is sounding out a war cry, and it will not simply go away. It can, however, be stopped, and something far greater built in its stead. As a class, and as a species, we must answer but one question. Luckily, it is simple. Socialism or extinction?